best gallbladder. And when we have D3 working, it is a premier agent for the integrity and function of all mucous membranes, especially the intestine and the lung. So this can be a huge, giant step for you, these couple things. And it's where I would go instantly to see if you aren't a lot better. And you're getting a warning here with regard to your digestion that most people don't get. And so it's going to be a real blessing. You turn the adversity to your advantage, and you get yourself a 20, 30 more good years instead of garbage years. Okay?
All right.
Okay, take care.
Thanks.
You're welcome. Bye now. All right, this is Dr. Bob Marshall. We're just about out of time. Don't miss nucleotides and colostrum. Everybody ought to have these at home. Buy one, get the second one 50% off. Just give a buzz to our order line, 800-370-3447, 800-370-3447. Be good to yourself. Take care of that great body you've been given. Bye for now.
You've been listening to Dr. Bob Marshall, Ph.D. on Healthline Live. To find out more about these specials or any of our great products, call 1-800-370-3447. That's 1-800-370-3447. Dr. Marshall's comments have not been evaluated by the FDA and are not intended to diagnose, treat, cure, or prevent any disease. Have a healthy and radiant day.
This is Larry Burnett. Don't forget open season Thursday at 3.05 p.m. here on KCAA. NBA Finals and a very special guest on the docket this week. So tune in Thursday at 3.05 here on KCAA, AM 1050, FM 106.5.
Inland Body and Paint is a family-owned and operated fleet collision and repair shop that's proud to live in and help our community. Bring your heavy-duty trucks and or equipment to their Fleet Collision and Paint Center in Fontana for expert collision repair services. With 35 years of experience, you're sure to receive quality workmanship at an excellent price from Inland Body and Paint Center. From fiberglass repairs to quality painting, they'll take care of your truck and equipment from top to bottom in their new 64-foot spray booth. By the way, Inland Body and Paint of Fontana repaired and repainted the KCAA truck, and they can do the same job for your car, truck, or heavy-duty equipment. Inland Body and Paint, dedicated to the community and to your satisfaction. Call them today to learn what they can do for you. You can find Inland Body and Paint on Valencia in Fontana. Call them at 909-434-0466 or online at inlandbodyandpaint.com.
Ontario's host Lions Club is hoping you'll come out to their 6th annual We Serve Golf Tournament. Check-in is at 11 a.m. Thursday, June 16th at Sierra Laverne Country Club. It supports 7 local charities and 8 area projects. Dean Munoz is the golf tournament chair. Give him a call at 909-481-1180. Come on out and golf to support the Ontario host Lions. 909-481-1180.
You're listening to KCAA, Loma Linda, California. The best station in the nation.
CNBC Radio. It looks like the May jobs report due out tomorrow. Maybe a good one. Today we learned private companies took on 173,000 new workers last month, which was more than expected, and that planned corporate layoffs in May were half what they were in April and the fewest in 1 month so far this year. That helped the markets turn around some early losses. The Dow today ending 49 points higher. The Nasdaq up 19, its 7th session in a row of gains. And oil closing right around $49 a barrel. Late earnings from teen retailer Zumiez, who had lost money last quarter, and same-store sales fell 7.5%. More bad news at the Gap, too. Same-store sales there tumbling 6% in May. If you can't get onto iTunes, it isn't you. Apple reporting outages at most of its services. And Walmart says it'll begin using drones, not for deliveries, but for inventory checks at its massive warehouses. I'm Tom Busby, CNBC Radio.
Goop, gunk, sludge, whatever you want to call it. It's the stuff that makes your engine just plain dirty. Luckily, the active cleaning power of Pennzoil conventional motor oil, just $3.39 a quart at Napa, helps keep your engine clean. So pick up Pennzoil conventional for $3.39 a quart at Napa and say goodbye to gunk. That's Napa know-how.
General States pricing. Sales prices do not include applicable state, local taxes, or recycling fees. Offer expires 6/30/16.
Good afternoon. It is 3:02. Open season straight ahead, but first a look at local and national news here on KCAA, 1050 AM and 106.5 FM. Fire officials say one person is dead after a Navy Blue Angels plane crashed this afternoon in Tennessee. The Rutherford County Department said one person was killed but did not say if it was the pilot. The crash happened near the town of Smyrna in the central part of the state. And boxing legend Muhammad Ali is in the hospital and being treated for respiratory issues. A rep for the 74-year-old says Ali is in fair condition at a hospital in Phoenix. The spokesperson says Ali is getting treatment from a team of doctors and expects only a brief hospital stay. Meantime, the boxer's family is asking for privacy. And a Minnesota woman killed in connection with yesterday's deadly shooting at UCLA is being identified as the shooter's wife. A Minneapolis TV station says Ashley Hasty and shooter Manark Sarkar were married in 2011. She was found dead in her home in Minneapolis. Authorities believe that in the last few days, Sarkar drove from Minneapolis to Los Angeles, where he shot and killed a UCLA professor yesterday. Another professor was also on his hit list, but that person was off campus at the time and was found safe. And finally, deputies continued to search a Southern California high school this afternoon over reports of an armed person on campus in Moreno Valley. Canyon Springs High remains on lockdown as the search goes on, but class work is resuming. Earlier in the day, the school received a report of a person with a gun on campus. Deputies stressed that this is not an active shooter situation, and there's no evidence anyone fired a weapon on the campus. Inland Empire weather. It is going to be very warm tomorrow with highs into the triple digits, and overnight lows going to be warm as well with lows down around 61 degrees. 94 right now is where we are at. We are at our high here in downtown San Bernardino. And then checking out your drive through Lake Elsinore, there's road construction going on 15 northbound at Diamond Drive, and that has the left lane blocked also in Lake Elsinore. On the 15 southbound, right there at Diamond Drive, a car has flipped over, and that's blocking the middle lane, so a lot of congestion in the Lake Elsinore area. Traffic is backed up from Nichols Road. Other than that, there's stop-and-go traffic, 15 southbound between the 10 and Harupa as you make your way through Ontario. The northbound 15 is slow from the 60 to Harupa, and in Moreno Valley, the 215 northbound is slow between Cactus and Alessandro, and the south 215 is slow from Barton Road to Central, 60 east slow from Rubidoux to the 215. And that is the very latest with news, weather, and traffic on the station that leaves no listener behind, KCAA 1050 AM and 106.5 FM.
Woohoo! It's time for Open Season with award-winning sportscaster Larry Burnett. Open Season, where they tackle issues, drop gloves, and swing for the fences. Hey, let's quit wasting time and dive right in to Open Season.
Open Season is on the air, in the air, and almost everywhere. Hello, Mr. and Mrs. Sports Fan, and all ships at sea. Today's special guest, ESPN baseball analyst Jessica Mendoza. Here's what's on the menu, kids. It's go time for the Cavs and Warriors in the NBA Final. In the NFL, the Rams may have a quarterback problem after all. On the ice, the Pens took a couple of shocks in the battle for the Stanley Cup. On the diamond, the Dodgers are unarmed and dangerous. Well, the Giants, Bumgardner, is armed and dangerous. And the Padres' bigwig calls his team miserable failure. Oh, my! All that, plus ESPN baseball analyst Jessica Mendoza. She's the only female baseball commentator working at the network level, and she's been causing quite a stir.
There's always a reaction to me, and that's what I've definitely noticed. Some people are positive and really excited. Some people are absolutely negative and like, get her out of there. What I don't find anyone in the middle yet.
Nobody in the middle. It's open season, where our motto remains, if it's news and sports, it's news to us. Hi, everybody. I'm Larry Burnett. This is open season. Our phone number, write it down. Keep it handy. 888-909-1050. 888-909-1050. Hey, thanks for being a part of our program here today. Eric Geller with me again this week on open season. He's been hanging out with the Rams, and later I'll be talking with ESPN baseball analyst Jessica Mendoza. Big story, as far as I'm concerned, Eric. Big one tonight. NBA Finals getting underway. We've got Cavs at Oakland for the first couple of games. I've got to tell you, it was about this time last week, I'm looking at the Golden State Warriors, and they're down 3-1 in their series to Oklahoma City. Oklahoma City was playing so great, and I thought, there's no way Golden State can beat them three games in a row and advance to the finals. Darned if they didn't do it and do it in style. There's something.
Yeah, it kind of reminded me of what the Clippers did last year with Houston. They looked unbeatable, and then they dropped three straight to the Rockets. But, yeah, they do look unbeatable. The Warriors do now, but there's all this conspiracy theory talk about, you know, wanting the Warriors to get back to play Cleveland. And, you know, but the Warriors are the Warriors. What amazes me about them is that they throw up shots that you're told never to throw up, and they go in every time. And I don't know what happened in Oklahoma City. I thought that front line of Adams and Cantor was obviously causing problems for them, and they were bringing some of those big guys out to guard Clay and Steph, and they were, it was working well, especially games 3 and 4, and they just couldn't get it done. It's a complete surprise, and I don't know what this means for Kevin Durant and his stay in Oklahoma City, if it's over or not, but that was really bad. They're getting a reputation now, I guess, like the Clippers. They can't close the deal.
Well, you know, and the problem was is that Durant and Westbrook were the problem. They, at times, they took quick shots. They didn't seem to play with poise. I think there was some finger-pointing going on that Oklahoma City team for a while. That's the kind of thing that could drive a guy somewhere else. Now, listen, he says all the right things. He says he loves playing in Oklahoma City. He says he loves his teammates. But if he's got an opportunity to go to, let's say, Golden State and maybe win some championships, does he go there? I don't know the
about
answer.
Miami, you know. Yeah, they play a hero ball. That's what the analysts call it. But I think it's kind of a panic thing. But I'm just surprised that that happened. I thought for sure they were going to put them away, especially in game 6. I mean, they had double-digit leads in all those games, just like the Clippers did 2 years ago, and they just couldn't, or last year, and they couldn't get it done. It's surprising, especially with those guys. Yeah,
that's
it.
All they had to do was win one game, and they couldn't do it. And, you know, give credit to Golden State. Now, here's the thing. Golden State put a lot of effort into getting the 73 wins. They've really had to work to get through the Western playoffs. And Cleveland's been sitting back and being rested. They haven't been all that tested except a little bit by Toronto. So
and
I think
healthy.
They come in, I think they come in fresh. I think they come in healthy, which they weren't last year when they lost in 6 games to Golden State. They didn't have Irving. They didn't have a healthy Kevin Love. They didn't have Channing Frye. They didn't have the depth that they have now. So you would think that the Cavs coming in would be a pretty good bet, but there's no way I'm betting against Golden State at this point, not after what they've been able to do.
No, and you can't really bet against them because, remember, they were the number one defensive team in the league during the regular season, and they showed their in the third quarter of Game 7, they completely shut down OKC, and they did the same thing in the fourth quarter of the game before. I think they won that quarter 33-18. So it's all about their defense, and Cleveland is exceptional defensively as well. So it's going to be a good battle, and they're healthy. I'm kind of going to go with Cleveland here, and a lot of people are saying – there's a conspiracy theory where everybody wants Cleveland to win and they're going to make it so. So I don't believe in all that stuff, but I think it's going to be a great finals, and I'm going to pick Cleveland.
All right, I'm going to go with Golden State. I just love the way they play. I love the depth that they have. I love the way they move the basketball.
I love them too.
I'm thinking maybe the over-under on three-point attempts tonight is around 40 or more.
Yeah, Cleveland puts them up as well, don't they?
Yeah.
So it might be even more than that. But, yeah, I'd go with the over.
It may be more than that.
Yeah.
Three-pointers are going to be key. I think the play of Andre Iguodala is going to be very big, because remember last year, he was the guy who came in and played defense on LeBron. And he was the guy who ended up being the most valuable player in the finals. So, you know, does he start for Golden State tonight? Do they bring him in? Does he exclusively get to play the defensive role on LeBron? I don't know. And over on the Cavs side of things, they had the coaching change in the middle of the year. You know, Tyronn Lue, he's pulled them all together. They made a nice trade to get Channing Frye. They got all the weapons.
They got him just to beat the Warriors, I think, to add that 3 point dimension from a big guy. So
and you got J.R. Smith who shoots the three. So I hope it's a great battle, because I can't think of anything that'd be a whole lot better than that Golden State Oklahoma City series.
Yeah.
So I hope this one lives up to that.
That
was phenomenal.
Yeah, this should be a lot of fun. And I mean, it was fun last year because LeBron just carried that team. And then they have I forget what his name is now. Dellavedova. Yeah. So he's fresh too. But the wild card, which is funny to me, is Anderson Varejão. He wins the championship ring no matter what, because he played majority of the season with Cleveland. I think that's kind of, is he going to sit? He might be just be sitting back and relaxing on a bench, because he's going to get a ring. But he's another one that could have a big impact on the game. He did that in the last game against Oklahoma City. He was big in that game for a few minutes there. So, and he knows those guys.
Yeah, he's not going to get a whole lot of playing time, but he'll make the most of the playing time that he does get. Now, you mentioned Varejão, a winner either way. Guess who else is a winner possibly either way? Mark Cuban. Mark Cuban owns the rights, the trademark, to the phrase City of Champions. So if the Warriors and the Sharks were to both win NBA Finals and Stanley Cup Final, if they wanted to print up T-shirts, hats, or anything else in the Bay Area that said City of Champions, Mark Cuban would get a major, major paycheck. It's just like Pat Riley with 3-peat. He trademarked it.
Right. So he trademarked City of Champions. So does Pittsburgh go him for all those years back in the day when the Pirates won and the Steelers won?
My guess is this has been kind of a recent transaction. You know, within
the Lakers had that on there for a while, I think. They had a T-shirt as well that said City of Champions.
Anybody who's got it on now has got to pay Mark Cuban.
Talk about a shark
tank. He's a shark, isn't he?
There you go.
Here's the other thing basketball-wise before we move on here. Jeff Hornacek going to the Knicks. They signed him to a 3-year deal. Is that a vote of confidence? 3 years? They gave Derek Fisher a 5-year deal he'd never coached before. Steve Kerr, Golden State, gave him a 5-year deal he had never coached before. Hornacek has had some success in the NBA. 3-year deal in New York.
He's such a low-key guy. He was a great basketball player. He could certainly shoot the lights out, but he's such a low-key guy. I just don't know. Is he going to be another puppet for Phil Jackson? Because he doesn't run the triangle offense.
He doesn't.
Sure. I don't know if they're going to scrap that. I don't know if Phil Jackson's like, okay, let's scrap it and let's do something else. But complete surprise, because you know he's such a low-key, quiet guy. He was in Utah for half of his career, so it's kind of strange. But he's he lost the Phoenix team, but for that 1 year he had him playing very well. So he knows what he's doing, obviously. But yeah, I don't see how that worked out or how that marriage got together.
But there's the key. He had the 1 year, and then he lost control of his team and got fired. What happens when he's up against the intense scrutiny in New York? I told you that it's like Opie does the Big Apple.
Sure.
But if I'm going in there, I'm not going in for anything less than a 5-year deal. We got to roll along here. Later on Open Season, you're going to hear from Jeff Fisher, Jared Goff, and Todd Gurley of the Rams. And up next, I'll chat with ESPN baseball analyst Jessica Mendoza. She's a mom. She's got 2 kids. She's trying to make her mark in the baseball broadcasting fraternity.
What I do love is that my kids get to see what I do. They're 2 boys. It's important for me to have them know that their mom is following her passion and doing something that is a little bit different and a little bit difficult. And I hope I can just set an example for them.
Have you ever gone to use a flashlight and the batteries were dead or the inside of the flashlight corroded, only having to throw it away, or in a location where you had no way to charge your cell phone or camera? Well, all that has changed. Now there's Hybrid Light. The Hybrid Light brings the best of both worlds together with a strong 160 lumen LED light that lasts 12 hours on a single charge, and after a recharge from any light or power source, you're ready to go again. Hybrid Light lasts 7 long years and is even waterproof, and also contains a USB port to plug in your cell phone or camera to give you that special charge when you're not near an outlet. All this for the low price of $39.95 with promo code GARY. Call 1-800-297-8109 and be the first to have this great tool, or go to our website, hybridlight.com. That's 800-297-8109 or hybridlight.com, HYBRIDLIGHT.com. And don't forget to use promo code GARY.
9MD Beverly Hills provides skincare solutions for patients undergoing cancer treatments. Personalized treatment regimens are initiated to achieve optimum remission states in those dealing with cancer. The IS Clinical Harmony Cancer Care Facial at 9MD Beverly Hills safely offers hope and relief for those challenged with the side effects and repercussions of intense cancer treatments such as radiation and chemotherapy. Rejuvenate, replenish, and soothe your skin. Let our certified technicians at 9MD Beverly Hills safely and effectively heal your skin with our IS Clinical products that are pharmaceutical grade, botanically based, paraben-free, and do not enter the bloodstream. Enjoy a day of pampering and revitalize your skin with 9MD Beverly Hills and our IS Clinical Harmony Cancer Care Facial for just $179. Each patient will receive a complimentary gift bag for take-home care. For more information, please call 310-777-7511 or visit us at www.9amd.com. That's www.9amd.com.
If you're trying to prevent a home foreclosure, you need the Goodman Law Firm on your side. Goodman has a nationwide network of foreclosure attorneys to represent you during the mortgage mitigation process. The Goodman Firm has resolved troubled mortgages across the nation. Take control of your mortgage situation today. Call the Goodman Law Firm, 888-800-6030, or contact them online at www.arnoldgoodmanlaw.com.
Welcome back to Open Season. We are very excited to have a special guest with us now. She is Jessica Mendoza. She is one of the analysts for ESPN Sunday Night Baseball, and she's a bit of a pioneer. I mean, you don't hear of too many women doing Major League Baseball, and she jumped in last August, jumped in well, and is continuing to do well, working with Dan Shulman and Aaron Boone on Sunday Night Baseball. So Jess with us now, and Jess, I have to ask you, you've worked your way into this baseball fraternity. So what has the ride been like for you over the last 9 months?
It's been a whirlwind, but I am absolutely hooked. And for me, it's been so nice to start this year knowing that I get to do baseball throughout the entire season. I mean, last year I jumped in September, you know, so to be able to really miss the first, you know, three quarters of the season and then come in and be in that seat on Sunday night, you know, I look back and I'm like, how did I do it? Like, how was I even able to have, you know, the information and the insight?
We're talking with Jessica Mendoza of ESPN. Let's bring the people up to speed on your background a little bit. You played college softball at Stanford. You played for the U.S. Olympic team. You were at ESPN from 2007 doing softball and some ESPNW and things. And then all of a sudden, the opportunity came up to do a Monday night game. And then just a few days later, Kurt Schilling pops off about Muslims and Nazis and everything else, and they move you into the Sunday night seat, and they haven't moved you out yet, have they?
No, that was, and to do my first game that Monday, like you mentioned, and then literally it was like 3 days later, they were like, you know, we'd like you to do Sunday. And that was kind of those deep breath moments. I'm like, all right, like, just did my first game. Here we go. Like, we got Cubs, Dodgers, and the course, that was Jake Arrieta's first no-hitter.
Yeah, not a
first
bad game,
first time
we've
ever had a no-hitter on Sunday Night Baseball to top it all off. But that's kind of just how things seem to, I don't know, it almost was meant to be in my mind. Like, because I was nervous too. I didn't know. You know, I'm sitting in this chair. Am I going to be good enough? You know, am I going to be able to look and see the game the way that I want to do it? Like, are nerves going to get the best of me? There were so many questions that I even had. But to be able to sit there and do that first game and just feel like, just feel good about the way that I was able to see it and the guys that I was working with. And to be honest, like a passion, like a real passion for this game. Obviously, it helps when you have a no-hitter and be able to talk about history. But even in every game that I've had since then, whether it's a blowout or just a tough, like, four-hour game, I'm so hooked on the fact that there's so much to this game that I feel like we can bring to a viewer that makes it so interesting. And sometimes I think we lose that. You know, I think over the course of nine innings, we lose what really makes baseball great.
Let me ask you about your preparation, because in my mind, that's the toughest part of the job and the most important part of the job. Calling the games is the easy stuff. But the preparation part of it, you know, going in as a female, do you feel that you have to work harder and maybe be more prepared than if it was a guy in the booth?
I mean, I know that I've never worked harder in my life for anything. It's been a ton of that. And that's been just me. Not even so much comparing me to, like, you know, a guy, as much as it just the pressure and the responsibility I put on myself. Like, I want to make sure if I'm going to do this and know that people are going to recognize my voice as being different and say, okay, wait, let me hone in a little bit closer on what she's saying to make sure that if she's saying something I don't agree with, or they're going to probably pay a little bit more attention. So I'm aware of that. And because of that, I want to make sure that I'm as prepared as I possibly can be. And that's, it's not easy. It's something that you think about 30 teams that play every single day. You think about, like, we have just two different teams every Sunday. There's just so much that's constantly changing. And I put it on myself to bring the viewer something that's happening right now, not so much maybe a year ago. And I try to challenge myself each week to do something that's a little different or something maybe a little more exciting or personalizing, whatever it might be. And it's a lot. And, you know, I feel like the nerves, I feel that kind of pressure every week, but at the same time, it's a privilege. Like I'm excited to be in this opportunity, but I'm not going to let off the gas at all. That's for sure.
Yeah. Talking with Jessica Mendoza of ESPN Sunday Night Baseball. Obviously you have the softball background from Stanford and the Olympic teams. And there are obvious comparisons and parallels between baseball and softball, but do you think you bring a different perspective to the game because of where you came from and where you are now?
Yeah. I mean, I think there's times that it's absolutely very similar. Like Boone and I will be talking about hitting and it's like zero difference. And then there's times where I get excited about something, especially with pitching, that I think to me is just so unique. And I like to think that sometimes I'm trying to represent a viewer that's maybe not super niche, someone that isn't just like absolutely has watched every single game possible and knows everything about the game. But maybe for me, it's more because I wasn't raised within the game. I didn't play it my entire life. I do bring, I feel like, something that is a little bit more unique, and I get really excited about stuff that maybe if I had been around it my whole life, I'd be like, yeah, come on, everybody knows that. Like, not a big deal.
Yeah.
You
have to know, Jess, that there are people who are going to see a woman in a baseball booth and they're going to say, well, she didn't grow up with it and she didn't play it all of her life. What's she doing calling, you know, baseball on ESPN? You must have heard flack like that.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I get it every week. I mean, and I know that with new audience, new people, like there's always a reaction to me. And that's what I've definitely noticed.
Right.
Some people are positive and really excited. Some people are absolutely negative and like, get her out of there. What I don't find anyone in the middle yet. I think my biggest goal is to get to where people are more like, oh, like, let's just listen. And maybe the criticism is more on what she's saying versus like her being, you know, wow, this is different. She didn't play. Let's just listen, you know? So yeah, right now it's extreme both ways.
I got to tell you though, if you're getting reactions, you're getting reactions. If you're right in the middle of the road, maybe it's wishy-washy. I mean, you may think it's extreme at this point, but at least you're getting reactions.
That's true. I guess it's more of just reactions to my gender.
I get it.
Where I want it to kind of be more, and I get it. Like, it's different, and I embrace that. Trust me. Like, it's a responsibility that I've taken on, and I like that we're probably reaching a different kind of viewer because of it, and I think that's great.
Yeah.
It's more of just with my analysis. You know, just me being able, like, I really try hard to give consistently good analysis that I believe is, you know, factual, coming in my own opinion. I don't think everyone's going to agree with it. I think there's going to be times that it's going to be like, well, I don't think that curveball was necessarily, you know, I get all of that.
Right.
But just don't add in, well, she's a female or she didn't play. Like, just listen. That's all I guess I really want.
All right, that's Jessica Mendoza. She's one of the analysts for ESPN Sunday Night Baseball. We'll have more with Jess later. We'll talk about the balancing act that she's doing right now between being a network announcer and being a mom. And we'll find out who her favorite team was when she grew up in Camarillo, California. Hey, Eric, I've watched her. I've listened to her. I think she does a good job. I think she brings a fresh perspective. But she knows she's got to work cut out for her, because she's got to win over, you know, diehard baseball fans who, well, what's a woman doing in the booth, and she never played the game, and so on and so forth. And it's not going to be easy. It's not.
No, but, you know, I think it's good that she's embracing it, and people are watching her, maybe to criticize her more than anything, but at least people are watching her and they're taking notice of her. And if they think she doesn't know the perspective of what it's like to play baseball, they need to try and hit a softball pitcher. I mean, a fast pitch softball pitcher. It's pretty intimidating, and it's a blur. So, you know, good for her. And, you know, for me, it's always been, whoever you are, embrace who you are and be proud of who you are and impart that knowledge, and don't try to be someone you're not. And there's nothing she can do. She is who she is. And that's great. And I think she's going to do a great job. And I saw her the other night, and, you know, I didn't have any complaints, obviously. So if she knows what she's doing, and she obviously does,
that's
worth
the thing.
It to go. Yeah.
That's the thing. If she doesn't know what she's talking about, people will be all over her, and she'll be out of that booth in a second. She will not get away with mistakes that the guys in the booth might possibly get away with. Before we head to a break, the Dodgers threw the kid, 19-year-old Julio Urias, at Chicago today. He lost 7-2, gave up 3 home runs. He pitched 5 innings, gave up 6 runs, 5 earned run, had 1 walk and 4 strikeouts. I'll tell you what, you know, this kid, they bring him up, and his first game is in New York against the Mets, and then they send him down and they bring him up. His second game is at Wrigley Field against the Red Hot Cubs. He is getting an indoctrination under fire, no question.
It certainly isn't AAA. I think maybe, you know, it's good for him, I guess, but maybe they should have waited until the weekend with the Braves in town. I think that would have been a little bit better for him.
Yeah, well, the problem they had was that Maeda had a hand problem. They want to push him back. Alex Wood is out for probably a month now. So they threw him in, and the results were not that great.
Sure.
Once again. All right, we'll talk more baseball later on Open Season. Plus, we'll have part 2 of my interview with Jessica Mendoza. And up next, we're going to talk L.A. Rams. Their new quarterback is in camp, but their old quarterback isn't. And the new quarterback, Jared Goff, is off to a pretty good start in his OTAs.
I feel like every day I come out here, you know, I get a little bit better every day. I learn a little bit more. So it's gone really well so far.
Ever wonder how celebrities get their skin red carpet ready? Look no further than the Fire and Ice Facial from Is Clinical, available at Nina MD Beverly Hills. The Fire and Ice Facial is an amazing clinical treatment designed to rapidly and safely regenerate the skin, reducing fine lines and wrinkles for an envious glow, while smoothing and softening to achieve that ageless face. Excellent for all skin types and ages, Is Clinical's Fire and Ice Facial is a celebrity favorite and provides dramatic results with no downtime, peeling, or side effects. The Fire and Ice Facial is normally $215, but call 310-777-7511 now. Mention this ad and pay only $179. That's over $35 in savings just by mentioning this ad. Don't miss out on glowing and radiant skin from Is Clinical and Nina MD Beverly Hills. For more info, visit ninamd.com or call 310-777-7511. That's 310-777-7511. Ever wonder how celebrities get their skin red carpet ready? Look no further than the Fire and Ice Facial from Is Clinical, available at Nina MD Beverly Hills. The Fire and Ice Facial is an amazing clinical treatment designed to rapidly and safely regenerate the skin, reducing fine lines and wrinkles for an envious glow while smoothing and softening to achieve that ageless face. Excellent for all skin types and ages, Is Clinical's Fire and Ice Facial is a celebrity favorite and provides dramatic results with no downtime, peeling, or side effects. The Fire and Ice Facial is normally $215, but call 310-777-7511 now. Mention this ad and pay only $179. That's over $35 in savings just by mentioning this ad. Don't miss out on glowing and radiant skin from Is Clinical and Nina MD Beverly Hills. For more info, visit ninamd.com or call 310-777-7511. That's 310-777-7511.
If you're trying to prevent a home foreclosure, you need the Goodman Law Firm on your side. Goodman has a nationwide network of foreclosure attorneys to represent you during the mortgage mitigation process. The Goodman Firm has resolved troubled mortgages across the nation. Take control of your mortgage situation today. Call the Goodman Law Firm, 888-800-6030, or contact them online at www.arnoldgoodmanlaw.com.
Back once again on Open Season, Larry Burnett along with Eric Geller, Di Rice at the controls on the Good Ship Open Season, and glad to have you with us. Hopefully you will be a part of our program, and our phone number here is 888-909-1050 if you would like to do just that. Eric's been hanging out with the LA Rams this week out at their OTAs in Oxnard. How'd they look so far?
They look pretty. I mean, everybody's in camp except for three guys, including Nick Foles. We'll talk about that. And Trey Mason and TJ McDonald have legal issues they're taking care of. But everybody looked good. And for a while there, I thought Tavon Austin wasn't there, but he likes to wear the number one during OTAs and practices like that and team workouts instead of number 11. So I think he wants to make sure everybody knows he's the number one receiver, maybe. I don't know. But they look pretty good. And the three quarterbacks that were there, Case Keenum looked good. Goff looked good, and Sean Mannion, who's the quiet guy, he's the guy from Oregon State. I think he was a second round or third round pick last year, but he looks pretty good as well.
Yeah, he was a good college quarterback, no question about that. Okay, so when the Rams drafted Jared Goff out of Cal with the number one pick, the writing was kind of on the wall for Nick Foles, who started last year as a starting quarterback and then lost his job. It looked as though he wasn't going to be in the plans. But you kind of figured he'd be at the OTAs and he'd come compete for a job, but he hasn't done that. Why? Well, let's listen and see what head coach Jeff Fisher said to his team yesterday about why Foles was not in camp.
I explained to the players that he has not been here and participated in the offseason program since the draft. And I've had conversations with Nick. And we're on the same page, and we're trying to work things out. And, you know, that's pretty much all I can say. These are voluntary. We have three quarterbacks on the field right now. It's hard enough to get reps for all three of them. So we're in the process of sorting things out with Nick. It has nothing to do with him not wanting to come in and compete at all. He's very, very competitive. We appreciate everything he did for us and, you know, his leadership. His teammates miss him, but, you know, I don't have any more information on that. We're just trying to work things out.
So, you know, a couple of things here. First of all, yes, it does have something to do with him not wanting to come in and compete. If he wanted to come in and compete for the job, Nick Foles would be in Oxnard this week working out with the team and trying to win the number one job. And the other thing that's in there, did you hear Jeff Fisher say, we appreciate all he did for us?
Yeah.
Past tense.
Yeah.
It's past tense. He's gone.
Yeah. the writing's on the wall. And when they traded for that number one pick, if you didn't see that, I think maybe his agent said to just wait and see what happens. But he's definitely gone. And listen, they've invested so much in Jared Goff, and he's a Jeff Fisher guy, basically, at this point. He's Jeff Fisher's draft pick. And they've invested so much in him, and even Sean Mannion as well. They've invested a lot in him. He's a Jeff Fisher guy. So he's gone, like you said, and I know that they're just waiting.
Jeff Fisher was in St. Louis when the Rams made the deal to get Nick Foles.
Yeah, they just needed a quick fix. Yeah, well, because obviously they traded for the same quarterback. Sam Bradford was the almost identical to what Nick Foles is, and they should have just kept Sam Bradford. Sam Bradford was the victim of a bad offensive line and receivers dropping footballs, as well as some of his bad play and his injuries, of course. And the same can be said about Nick Foles. But Nick Foles had that one great year, and that's usually what it takes for you to get a big contract. And look at Ryan Fitzpatrick. He had a great year one year, and now he had a good year last year, obviously, and now he's sitting out because he can't get a raise. So it's crazy, and the Jets are one of these teams that might be in the market for a trade with Nick Foles.
It could be. They've offered Fitzpatrick a raise, but it's not the raise that he wants. So he's sitting out, and there's some thought that some of the receivers stayed away from OTAs last week as kind of a protest that they hadn't taken care of Fitz. So there's a lot of stuff going on. Let's check in with Jeff Fisher one more time and see if we can clarify exactly what's going on and why Nick Foles isn't in Rams camp.
Well, I think Nick has the feeling that if things stay the same, he's probably not going to be on the roster. But beyond that, it was more of a mutual thing. Not that we said don't come. It was just say, hey, coach, I just rather stay away until we get things worked out. And I said, I'm fine with that.
I'm just not fine with that. And I don't understand the world of sports as it relates to the world of business. If I've got a job and they bring in somebody younger than me that they think can do that job, but I'm still on the payroll, I go to work, and I do my job, and I don't stay home and say, I'm not comfortable being there. But by the way, keep sending my checks. Yeah. It doesn't work that way in any other part of our society except sports. I don't get it.
Yeah. Well, and considering also that I think it's a $6.3 million signing bonus he received from the Rams in March. So he's getting paid a lot of money to sit out. If I'm a guy, and you and I talked about this before the show, but for me, if they bring someone else in, well, fine. I still think I'm the best person for that job, and they're gonna have to prove to my boss, to me, and someone else that this person that they brought in is better than I am. And if not, at least he's showing his skills and he's auditioning for other teams, because that's right. Right now, the Rams can't seem to get any kind of offers for him. I think a lot of teams are just waiting for the Rams to possibly waive him. So for me, if you bring him, I mean, he's only going to cost $1.7 million to a team that's going to pick him up, whether via trade or through the waiver wire. So if I'm Nick Foles, he's a young guy. He's a young quarterback, and he's obviously got the skills and the talent, maybe not elite talent, but he did have 27 touchdowns, right? So 27 touchdowns, two interceptions a couple years ago, which was phenomenal. And I think he had 7 touchdowns in one game against the Raiders that year. But you come in and play, and you show what you got, and someone will want you, and they'll pay you. So
that's the way I look at it. What do you think it's going to take if the Rams can make a trade? What do you think it would take for them to give him up in a trade?
Get a low round draft pick, a fifth or a sixth round draft pick.
Fifth or sixth, makes sense to me. Now, with all this going on, you got Goff out there, and he's the number one pick, and he's got this giant playbook that he's trying to digest, and everybody's asking questions about Foles and everything else. And I kind of like what Goff said yesterday. Let's listen to his what he thinks is going on with Nick Foles.
I don't know anything about that. It's between Coach and Nick, and they're dealing with that.
This guy, he's a Cal guy.
I asked him the question.
He's smart.
Yeah. Well, of course he's a smart guy, so he knows what's going on, and he's got that demeanor. Remember, his idol growing up, he's from the Bay Area, is Joe Montana. That's why he wears number 16. And remember, everybody called Joe Montana Joe Cool. And, you know, Joe was a very smart guy. He still is, obviously. So, I think nothing.
I don't know.
Nothing,
he's doing those Papa John's commercials, and I'm not sure. He may not be as smart as we think he is.
Well, you know, if he only has to have one slice during a commercial, you know, when they produce it, he gets all the money in his pockets. But, you know, Goff, listen, there's so much riding on Goff. He better walk the walk, and, you know, we'll see what happens. But he looks very good in practice. He looks extremely good. And they're happy with him because he doesn't make mistakes. And a lot of times, what Coach Fisher explained yesterday was that when he had the rookie free agents in a couple of weeks ago, well, these guys didn't know what the routes were and they didn't know how to cut. Well, now he's working with the veterans and he's already launching the footballs where they have to be. And some of these guys are impressed by his skill level already.
All right, with all that in mind, let's check in with head coach Jeff Fisher of the Rams and see what he thought about Jared Goff in day one of the OTAs.
He's done a great job. I mean, there's a lot involved, but it takes time. But, you know, he's way ahead of where he was even a week ago. And so, you know, and that's only going to get better as we move through the next couple of weeks. You know, he's going to get more and more reps. There may be a day where he gets all the number one reps before we're done with camp. And that doesn't mean to say, it certainly doesn't mean to say you want a job, but it means to say he's developing in the offense and you want to give him that opportunity.
Yeah, and you want to see what he can do with the big front line in front of him and with the real running backs and the first string wide receivers running the routes that they do. All right, more sound here from Rams OTA. Here's Jared Goff talking about how he feels he's doing so far.
Good. You know, a lot of learning, just trying to, you know, catch up with the speed and learn as best I can. And I feel like every day I come out here, you know, I get a little bit better every day, learn a little bit more. So it's gone really well so far. It's not anything that seems overwhelming. I'm picking it up at a pretty good pace, I think, and feel really good as far as how fast I've picked it up and am able to apply most of it out here. And again, there's mistakes, but that happens. I mean, I'm young and learning. So when there is a mistake, you know, you just learn from it and try not to let it happen again. You know, continuing to try to fit in with these guys and mesh with them as best I can. And, you know, a lot of the guys have been really, really welcoming, really supportive. There has been zero, you know, negative things to say about anybody on the team. It's all been very, very positive, very supportive, and very helpful. I mean, even with Case and Sean, they've been very helpful, and it's been a really good experience so far.
Yeah, but what about Nick Foles? Why isn't he in camp? Well, you know, I don't have anything to say about that. That's between Nick and head coach Jeff Fisher.
You gotta
love it, right?
You know, he reminds me of, you know, Troy Aikman, you know, just the way the carries himself, Peyton Manning. Those guys were cerebral quarterbacks, obviously, and Joe Montana as well, like we said. But and he's that way, and he doesn't care. He's just worried about getting better. So listen, he's going to be starting in that Monday night game up in Santa Clara. I guarantee that.
Yeah, you said that a few weeks ago. Before we head to the break, let's check in with the highest authority available from Rams camp. That would be Todd Gurley, the running back, and see what he thinks about the quarterback, Jared Goff.
Oh, I like him, man. Definitely a good quarterback. He's gonna be doing big things. So I'm excited to, you know, to see what else he does doing OTAs and camp.
What do you like that you've seen from him?
You know, just his composure. You know, real chill, laid back type of guy, and he can sling it, man. Guys has a quick release. You know, I'm not a quarterback guru, but you know that's all I see. He's got a quick release. So, but you know, a lot of improvement. That's why we're in OTAs right now, so we can get better.
Yeah, I'm not a quarterback guru either, but I play one on the radio.
Exactly.
And,
yeah.
we'll see what happens. By the way, they're going to move the Pro Bowl from Hawaii to Orlando. I don't know if anybody cares. They say they're going to change the format. I don't know if anybody
cares.
It's
back to AFC, NFC. That's all I'm saying.
Well, thank goodness for that. who knows?
Hey, I was at the last Pro Bowl that was at the Coliseum way back in the day, so... Tom Mack was the MVP of that game, the offensive
Tom
lineman.
Tom Mack.
How do you win the MVP as an offensive lineman in a game like
practice?
Was it the Coliseum? There you go.
practice. All right, we're going to head to the break. We've got the NHL playoffs to talk about, more baseball coming up on Open Season. And speaking of baseball, Eric, part two of my interview with ESPN analyst Jessica Mendoza is just around the corner. And guess who grew up as a big league Dodger fan?
We had season tickets growing up. I mean, Vin Scully was the voice in grain. I thought I was probably related to him as a child because I heard his voice more than some of my aunts and uncles.
If you're trying to prevent home foreclosure, you need a law firm with extensive experience representing clients in protecting their homes from foreclosure. The Goodman Law Firm is a nationwide team of mortgage mitigation attorneys that provides legal advice and expertise you can trust. Our nationwide network includes local of-counsel foreclosure attorneys to represent you during the mortgage mitigation process. The Goodman Firm has represented homeowners across the nation in resolving their troubled mortgages. We have the experience and the knowledge you can count on to best represent your interests. The banks have attorneys fighting to protect their interests, and so should you. Call the Goodman Law Firm at 888-800-6030. Take control of your mortgage situation today. Contact us at 888-800-6030 or through our website at arnoldgoodmanlaw.com.
Have you ever gone to use a flashlight and the batteries were dead or the inside of the flashlight corroded, only having to throw it away, or in a location where you had no way to charge your cell phone or camera? Well, all that has changed. Now there's Hybrid Light. The Hybrid Light brings the best of both worlds together with a strong 160 lumen LED light that lasts 12 hours on a single charge, and after a recharge from any light or power source, you're ready to go again. Hybrid Light lasts 7 long years and is even waterproof, and also contains a USB port to plug in your cell phone or camera to give you that special charge when you're not near an outlet. All this for the low price of $39.95 with promo code GARY. Call 1-800-297-8109 and be the first to have this great tool, or go to our website, hybridlight.com. That's 800-297-8109 or hybridlight.com, hybridlight.com. And don't forget to use promo code GARY.
Back again on Open Season on Thursday afternoon. Larry Burnett with Eric Geller. Stanley Cup Finals, Pittsburgh and San Jose. They've been tight games. They haven't been high-scoring games. Pittsburgh has won the first two, and last night they had to go to overtime. It was one of the most interesting plays I've seen in a long time, Eric, because you see Sidney Crosby skating up there for the faceoff, and he kind of backs off. He goes over to one of his teammates by the boards and says something. Then he comes in, just steals the faceoff, gets the puck right back to the guy at the point. He gets it inside. They take the shot. Connor Sheary, the winning goal in overtime, and the Penguins have a 2-0 lead in that series as it shifts to San Jose. You just don't see things develop in front of your eyes like that. And after the game, the players were all saying, oh, yeah, Sidney came back and he said, well, I'll get it to you, and then don't you shoot. You get it to so-and-so, and then he'll shoot, and we'll be fine. And it just played out exactly the way he said it.
Yeah, guys like Gretzky, Solani, Lemieux are the only ones that really do stuff like that. So he's in that conversation. It's kind of surprising he's going after his second Stanley Cup in an 11-year career. Time flies. But yeah, Chris Letang was the defenseman that he went up to and said, hey, man, don't shoot the puck. Just, you know, we got to pass it into the crease there. The guy will be open. And it worked. That's amazing to me. And there, you know, San Jose is in a lot of trouble now. Three of the last six Stanley Cup winners were down 2-0 and they came back and won. But this is their first time in the Stanley Cup Finals. I don't know.
That's
tough. This is Pittsburgh and Sidney Crosby, and they know how to win that. So
and Pittsburgh is quick. I mean, they are just so quick, and they know how to screen. Martin Jones on one of the goals last night, I mean, he never ever saw it.
They
just never had a chance at it. So they'll play games 3 and 4 Saturday and Monday at San Jose. We'll see if the Sharks can get back into it.
At least one.
Yeah, we'll see. Other hockey note, Blues head coach Ken Hitchcock says he's going to return next season, but it's going to be his final season as an NHL head coach. All right, we're switching back to baseball now to talk with Jessica Mendoza. She's in her first full season as an analyst for ESPN's Sunday Night Baseball. She got thrown into the job last summer when Curt Schilling was suspended for making some controversial remarks, and then she got the job full-time when Schilling he couldn't keep his mouth shut. So Mendoza got the job. She's a mom. She's got two kids. She's making the most of the ESPN opportunity. And she was also very candid when I talked with her about her role on Sunday Night Baseball. Listen in. You've been quoted as saying that you want people to listen and have fun. I've talked to some people at ESPN, and they say, you know, part of Jess being on the broadcast is we want to bring more female viewers in. Do you feel a responsibility there?
Absolutely. I mean, I think when I talk to a lot of my friends, and, you know, they just don't tune into baseball a lot, but they're watching the NFL, they're watching the NBA. Like, part of it sometimes it's entertainment. Part of it is teach me, tell me. Like, a lot of women that I know, they don't want to feel like you're talking over them.
Right.
And I think a lot of times when they want to feel included. And again, my gender isn't as easy as, like, if you just do this, more women will watch. I mean, everyone knows every female is different. But to me, it's more of just, you know, I am a mom, and I am things that I feel like are more relatable to a lot of the women that I know and talk to. And I think the reach for me is more about just reaching more people and not just feeling like you have to fit this mold to watch this broadcast. You can be anybody, and I think you're going to be entertained, whether it's because you love the game or because you think Jose Altuve is really interesting because of his height and his personality. Like, there's a whole spectrum that the game can bring you besides just an ERA and a batting average.
Jessica Mendoza is our guest here on Open Season. You brought up the fact that you're a mom, and this isn't a question that I would ask to a guy, so maybe it's not fair, but how do you balance the work and the family?
It's not easy. I mean, I'm on a 15-day road trip right now, and, you know, this gigantic suitcase and FaceTiming with my kids, and they do travel with me. I'm so excited for summer to be here because school is out. They'll be able to come with me on a lot of trips, but it's not. Sometimes I cringe at the word balance only because life to me never is in balance.
Right.
It was never like that even when I was a student at Stanford. There was times my academics were hanging over my head because I was spending too much time in the weight room, you know, and then that would switch. Right now, there's times when, you know, I'm working and on the road so much, I miss my kids like crazy and I just want to be home. There's times I'm home and I'm feeling like I'm missing and I should be watching a game when I'm not. And it's just a matter of not letting it sway one side for too long, to where that it does sway back, and knowing that life is never going to be, at least for me, perfectly balanced.
Yeah.
But what I do love is that my kids get to see what I do. They're two boys. It's important for me to have them know that their mom is following her passion and doing something that is a little bit different and a little bit difficult. And I hope I can just set an example for them.
Well, you know what I've found over the years is that if you're really serious about your profession and about your family, you always feel like you're giving too much to one and not enough to the other. You know, I'm putting too much into my job, not paying enough time to my family. I'm putting too much into my family, not paying enough attention to my job. You can't win.
No, never. And I've learned to accept that because I think the guilt is what will get you, at least for me. If you're constantly guilting yourself for the time that you don't have, for me, it's never going to be perfect, ever. And I want to do this. I love my job. I love the fact that I'm a mom, and I don't want to change anything, but I have to be okay with the fact that sometimes it's not going to be perfect. In fact, most of the time, it's not going to be perfect.
Jess, there's so much made about you being a female in the booth, and yet your last name is Mendoza, and I haven't heard a whole lot about your Hispanic background or if you feel that you're carrying that banner to ESPN every Sunday night as well.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's kind of sometimes unspoken because my last name, my background, my father's family is from Mexico, and there's a big pride from my father especially, because I don't think he ever imagined it would be a female in our family, but there is such a deeply rooted baseball part in his culture and, like, really the transition from his family coming over to America. And it's a beautiful story that I feel like I've tried to more expose through the stories of the players that I'm covering. I did a whole thing on Venezuela in one of our Astros games, and I was extremely passionate about bringing attention to a lot of the issues that were happening with their government in Venezuela, but more so because of the fact that these players, when you think about Latin players, a Latino player, they're not grouped all together as Dominican, Puerto Rican, Venezuelan, Cuban. Each country has their own individual backgrounds. And that was something I really pushed on Sunday night, was to talk more and bring more attention. So those are things that I think are subtle, but I'm not waving the flag. Well, my last name is Mendoza, so I want to do a Spanglish interview. It's more of, I just think this is a part of the game of baseball that I was raised knowing. And I feel like it's been, we're almost cheating the viewer to not let them know this side of baseball as well. I think we really need to think about the variety of people that are on the other side of this telecast and who we're really trying to hone in. And that's something that I just am always conscious of, always. Anytime we talk about an element or something we want to do, who are we trying to reach? And I think the broader and the more people that we can get watching this game, it's a beautiful game. I may sound biased, but this is someone coming in that didn't grow up in it. I didn't play Major League Baseball, and I'm coming in saying that I absolutely think this game is for everybody.
I have to ask you, if you grow up in Camarillo, California, is there any other choice but to grow up a Dodgers fan?
Yeah, I mean, we had season tickets growing up. I mean, Vin Scully was the voice ingrained. I thought I was probably related to him as a child because I heard his voice more than some of my aunts and uncles. I have so many memories. I grew up in the 80s, you know, Dodger games. Is there a better time to be a fan of the game and to be able to watch so many of the players? Brett Butler was actually my favorite player, which nobody really knows. But like, because of all the, you know, you think it'd be Kirk Gibson or Oral Hershiser. I love them too, but Brett Butler was like the guy that I watched his swing from like 5 years old on. And yeah, the Dodgers, they were my team, absolutely.
There you have it. That is Jessica Mendoza. You can catch her on ESPN Sunday Night Baseball, and we appreciate her being on Open Season and wish her a lot of luck. Keeping in this baseball mode, Eric, how about Mookie Betts for Boston? 5 home runs in the past 2 games. Now, this isn't Big Poppy up there. This is like little guy up there. One of the things I like about baseball is you don't have to be a giant to be a big leaguer, and this guy, 5 home runs in his last 2 games. Amazing.
He's in a zone. I guess, you know, they say when you're playing, you're playing well and you're making contact with the ball, it looks like a huge beach ball. So obviously he's in a zone right now. And I think it's a lot of fun. He's basically someone no one's really ever heard of. And now he's put his name right up there and everybody's watching him and to see if he can hit more home runs. And I think he will.
We'll see what happens. Madison Bumgarner got another win today. He beat the Braves, shut him out. 11 strikeouts and also hit another home run. This guy is amazing. The Dodgers lost to the Cubs today. They'll start a 6-game homestand Friday against the Braves and then the Rockies. They'll throw Kershaw on Saturday. And then after the homestand, they've got 3 at San Francisco and 3 at Arizona. The Angels are in last place in the American League West. Friday, they'll start a 3-game set at Pittsburgh, then 4 at the Yankees. Mike Trout hit over 340 back in May with 26 runs and 27 RBIs. But not enough to get the Angels off the snide. And before we go, San Diego Padres executive chairman Ron Fowler called his team miserable failures yesterday in a radio interview. He went after pitcher James Shields, said he was an embarrassment, and said that in the real world, if people worked like that, they'd be unemployed. I don't know about you.
Dodgers will
I like
take
the freshness of hearing it, but if I'm a player, I don't want to hear that from my owner.
Well, that's too bad. That's how it usually works in the real world. So, hey, maybe the Dodgers can pick him up. Maybe he fits the sabermetrics.
We'll see what happens. Thanks to Eric Geller. Thanks to Di Rice. Thanks to everybody for tuning in. And thanks to Jessica Mendoza of ESPN Sunday Night Baseball. Have a great week, everybody. We'll see you next Thursday right here on Open Season at 3:05 p.m. Until then, get out and try to have some fun.
Yeah, we'll have fun, not a day, just a T-bird away.
You're listening to KCAA. Loma Linda, California.
CNBC Radio. Uncle Sam is cracking down on the payday loan industry. The Consumer Financial Protection Bureau proposing tough new federal regulations on payday loans and other high-interest loans that are made to desperate borrowers, many of them without bank accounts or any savings, who often need emergency cash right away. Encouraging data today about jobs, one day ahead of tomorrow's big May employment report. That helps send stocks higher. The Dow today up 49 points. The Nasdaq added 19. Its seventh day straight of gains. Initial jobless claims down again last week, down by 1,000. Private employers took on a better-than-forecast 173,000 new workers in May. And the numbers for April revised higher. And planned corporate layoffs last month, down about 30,000, the fewest in 1 month so far this year. And finally, Walmart testing out using drones to help manage its warehouse inventory. Tom Busby, CNBC.
Napa know-how!
Goop, gunk, sludge, whatever you want to call it. It's the stuff that makes your engine just plain dirty. Luckily, the active cleaning power of Pennzoil conventional motor oil, just $3.39 a quart at Napa, helps keep your engine clean. So pick up Pennzoil Conventional for $3.39 a quart at Napa and say goodbye to gunk. That's Napa know-how. General States pricing. Sales prices do not include applicable state, local taxes, or recycling fees. Offer expires 6/30/16.
You can learn to DIY just about anything.
Hey, gang. Today I'm going to show you how to deep fry a turkey. Now, we're going to need some bubbling hot oil and a vat and a few helpers, so I grabbed the kids.
After all, some things are better left to the pros, like buying a home. Because without an expert to guide you from open house to closing, you could be headed for a meltdown.
And now that the bird is cooking, let's take a power nap.
So DIY yourself a favor and get Realtor. Head to Realtor.com/getrealtor today. Realtors are members of the National Association of Realtors.
Good afternoon. 4:02 is the time. I'm Di Rice with the very latest in live, local, and national news here on KCAA 1050 AM and 106.5 FM. Officials are confirming that a Navy Blue Angels pilot is dead after a crash in central Tennessee this afternoon. The crash happened near the town of Smyrna. The pilot of the FA-18 Hornet was taking off to start an afternoon practice when the incident occurred. The other pilots taking part in the exercise were not hurt. The Blue Angels are scheduled to perform during the Great Tennessee Air Show this weekend. Democrat presidential candidate Hillary Clinton is coming to the Inland Empire this time for a 6:15 meeting tonight with community leaders at Casa Jimenez restaurant in Paris. Clinton's campaign described the private meeting, which is closed to the public, as a conversation with community leaders. The leaders' names and the topic of conversation have not been disclosed. It is the second Inland Empire stop for Clinton, who held a rally at UC Riverside May 24th. And deputies continue to search a Southern California high school this afternoon over reports of an armed person on campus. Canyon Springs High School in Moreno Valley was on lockdown all this afternoon. As the search went on, classes resumed. Earlier in the day, the school had received a report of a person with a gun on campus. Deputies stressed that it was not an active shooter. Inland Empire weather. Going to be a warm one tomorrow. Highs into the triple digits. 101 is what we're looking at. Overnight lows tonight also warm, about 61 degrees. Today's high was 95, which is currently where we are here in downtown San Bernardino. And then checking out your drive, there's not a lot going out there, so we do have some good news for you. There is, however, a little stop and go through Corona, 15 northbound between Temescal Canyon Road and Warwick. And also the southbound 15 is slow in pockets from the 10 to 2nd Street, and then once again from Magnolia to Warwick. And this report has been brought to you by a Foundation for a Better Life. Winston Churchill's words stirred his country in the face of defeat. Today, they inspire us to reach for our own victories. Commitment, pass it on. From the Foundation for a Better Life at values.com. Join Richard C. Hoagland on the other side of midnight from 12 to 2 a.m. Pacific Time, Tuesday through Saturday, right here on KCAA, the station that leaves no listener behind.
Plexus Slim.
The pink drink. It works. Finally, there is a healthy solution to help you lose weight, experience quick results, and keep the weight off. People around the country are experiencing amazing results, and you can too. Plus, right now, you can try it free for 7 days. Just email your name, address, and phone number for a free sample to tryplexusfree@gmail.com. The pink drink. It works.
On this week's My Awesome Empire, we're in Riverside and Fontana to meet the Community Connect leader whose program is saving and elevating hundreds of thousands of lives, and the president of the racetrack that saved a city. This week, My Awesome Empire. Saturday at 5 p.m. on KCAA 106.5 FM and 1050 AM.
This is the Tom Hartman Program.
And greetings, my friends, patriots, lovers of democracy, truth, and justice, believers in peace, freedom, and the American way. Tom Hartman here with you, and, well, a lot of interesting stuff happening all around the world. And, of course, it's anything goes summer, but